Right, Jim, thanks for talking to me today. You've just been at Celtic Connections performing La Banda Europa. Well, it's an amazing 35 musicians from all over Europe. Did you enjoy it?
36.
36?
Yeah, none of your 35s. Yeah, I enjoyed it actually. It was, it's always a bit of a rod for my back doing these things, and it's a very ambitious project, and it's not easy bringing 36 people from 15 different European countries to one place. The logistical side of it is challenging, but it's really worth it. It's amazing to get them together.
And the gig was very well received.
It was actually. It was interesting with people like the culture minister who turned up at the gig tweeting really lovely things about the band and about me, you know what a nice coat I have. Not.
But you love a big project.
I do, you know, it's a funny thing. I mean, all these things like Stulig and these kind of projects that I've done, you have an idea and then you go, right, well, okay, I've got this idea. And then you've got to wait. It's a long game. And it's you know, so with La Banda Europa, it started in 2006 really with an idea. In fact, before that, I'd been working on a film called Festival, which is a film by Annie Griffin and Chris Young. And Annie said, you know, would I work with some Anasanta bands in Seville? And they play these key bugles, which are a quarter tone above concert. And eventually we found this Anasanta band that I could work with. And Chris, the producer, said, what about getting a pipe band in as well? And I said, yeah, okay, well, let's give it a go, you know, not even thinking about whether we could do it or not. I think most ideas are possible, you know, I do really think that. And I think believing that ideas are possible is important. I think that's, if I didn't have a sort of ridiculous self-belief and sense of being able to achieve something, I kind of wouldn't be doing this stuff, you know. And so we brought the Drambuie pipe band over to Spain and recorded 17 music cues for the film festival, along with a Semana Santa band, an 80-piece Semana Santa band. So we had, you know, over 100 people in the studio. And and I remember listening to this music that I'd written for these two bands together and thinking, oh, that sounds really European. There's something amazing about this Mediterranean bugle band. They're not strictly bugles, they're a bit like flugelhorns, like they're of the saxhorn family, along with these pipers. We were a quarter of a tone above concert as well, so it was a kind of marriage made in heaven. And I remember listening to this music and thinking it sounded really European, thinking, well, what would it be like to make a band that makes the sound of Europe, that somehow or other makes the sound of Europe? And that kind of got me on the road for it. And I'd heard about these Creative Scotland Awards, and I at the time, when the Scottish Arts Council was giving out these £30,000 awards, and I thought, I'll give that a go. And I tried it the first year, didn't get it. Tried it the second year, I didn't get it. And then in 2006, I went to the Cultural Enterprise office, and they coached me to do this application. And they helped me make the application. I thoroughly recommend the Cultural Enterprise Office. And they helped me get the application together, and I got the funding. I got a hold of Neil Butler from UZ Events, and he helped by with his organisation In Situ, which is a big European network of partners, many of whom run festivals around Europe. And they helped to get European funding into the project. And Newcastle Gateshead Initiative were doing a project that was about St George's Day, that was to celebrate Englishness. And they wanted to celebrate Englishness by having an international project. So they booked La Banda Europa. So the combination of finding a producer and a producing organisation In Situ, finding a gig in Newcastle Gateshead Initiative, and actually we did it in Big and Falkirk as well, and also finding that wee bit of funding from what was the Scottish Arts Council, which gave me money to actually go out there and think about who was going to be in this band, was an amazing sort of coincidence of both funding and people that made that work, and I was there, you know. So that was an amazing thing.
So this massive ambition that you've obviously got, you know, this the able to realise these great ideas, because that's a skill in itself, just having the confidence to say, well, I'm going to get this together, it's amazing. As a young musician growing up in Caithness, did it come from there?
I think if you grew up somewhere like Thurso, which is where I grew up, you either you say, well, this is where I live, this is where I'm going to be, this is my home, and this is my, you know, this defines me in some way. You know, some people are defined by their where they're born or their roots, and other people have ambitions beyond that, whatever that is. And I suppose I kind of, I don't know if I particularly had ambitions beyond that, but I just had to get away, actually. And so I moved down to Edinburgh and found myself in this kind of crazy melting pot of folk music. The Edinburgh Festival, which was happening then, Edinburgh Folk Festival, that was going on then. And I just thought, this is bonkers, you know, and got involved in folk music and sort of had been doing folk music in Thurso. And yeah, I was always ambitious. I remember Ian and Margie Sinclair, and Margie saying to me, Jim, you're quite ambitious. And like, this was maybe an unachievable thing, that I wanted to earn money as a writer of music, that I actually wanted to write music then as a 17-year-old. And it was a long time ago. And Margie saying, you're quite ambitious. And Ian saying, you know, I don't know if that's an easy thing to do, Jim, you know. Well, you know, that's what I want to do. And I was at the time doing an apprenticeship, and I just kind of got out of that and moved to Edinburgh.
What was your apprenticeship?
It's sort of electronics, and it was an instrument mechanic. And they called it hiss and piss because there was steam and stuff involved in it as well, gauges and all that kind of. So those kind of instruments and electronic ones. I wasn't very good at it.
So when you were in Thurso, what instruments were you playing?
Lots. I mean, I got. Remember my dad when I was 14, getting me a bazooki, and it was in the local music shop. It was just there, this second-hand bazooki. The local music shop didn't really have second-hand instruments, but there was this bazooki, which is a bit like a big mandolin with a long neck. For anybody who doesn't know what that is, it's Greek. I said, Dad, would you get me that? I think I was 14. Get me that, Dad. And he said, can you play it? And I said, well, you know, give it a go, you know. And then the next day I had it and I was in the living room. And it was just a kind of racket. My dad came in the living room and he said, I thought you said you could play that. And that was me sort of on the road to becoming a musician. And I sort of got into playing the baran and used to practice that with, because Caithness, there weren't many other baran players. There was a guy called Andy Corshie, and there was Margie Sinclair, and they both played the baran, and they both played it a bit differently from the way that I was finding my way into it. Andy made the first tunable baran for me, and people have copied that ever since. So all these tunable barans that you see with the ring inside the drum and tensioners tensioning down onto it, that was invented by this guy Andy Corsi in Thurso, and he doesn't get any credit for it, so I have to say that. But he's a good man, he's still alive. And he and Margie kind of gave me their skills on the baran. And I just practiced along with records of, you know, Dysart and Dundonald Pipe Band, John McLaughlin's Shakti, the jazz band, Indian jazz thing, and a great album of Paul Brady, Matt Malloy and Tommy Peoples album, which, you know, I believe they were touring this year. And those were the three albums that were on. I would play one after the other. And so I'd be playing one that I'd be playing with pipe band music, and the next minute I'd be doing Tommy Peoples, and the next minute I'd be battering away with tablas and stuff on Shakti. And so I must have been about 14, 15 then. And I was really having a go at that. I really liked it as an instrument. I was playing stuff like banjo and clarinet a bit, and had other bits and pieces, a double bass that I played with the school orchestra, big. And the school music teacher said, "You're big, how do you fancy the double bass?" And a whole bunch of other things, had a guitar, wanted to be Rory Gallagher. Then I realised that he didn't play the Baran. So, funny enough, I never became Rory Gallagher.
So, you obviously, you played with Merck up there, and then you came down to Edinburgh?
Yeah, I mean, Merck was a great thing for me because they come from a song tradition, they were really rooted in that tradition, and I got to meet people like Jane Turriff and the Stuarts and all these people, amazing people, source singers who aren't around anymore, and some of them are, through that, Arthur Argyll, all these people, amazing, Hamish Henderson, and all this. And so at a very young age, I was meeting very interesting people, some of whom were right in the tradition, and some of whom were, you know, really driving it along by collecting it and promoting it. And so I think I was really lucky to work with Merck. And then when I left Thurso, I sort of continued that for a little while and made an album. But probably ultimately, I fell in with a bunch of Shetlanders, Gary Peterson and Peter Miller and Davy Tulloch and all these guys, and ended up living in a flat, sharing a flat with these people, and Peary Willie Johnson coming in, and you think, wow, this is great, all this amazing stuff, and this old jazz guitar, and what's this? And, you know, Joe Venuti, Eddie Lang influences and all that. And so all this kind of, again, lots of really interesting sort of jazz influences, European jazz influences on what I was thinking about and what I was doing. So it gave me a sense of harmony without knowing that I had that particular sense of harmony. It broadened my sense of colour and also gave me an idea that you could, and the rhythm that it gave me was immense. So again, there was a big sort of party time with all these incredible people for a period of time, and eventually I met Jack Evans and Rod Patterson and Norman Chalmers, and in fact it was Jack and Rod and I, first of all, who were in a band together. They were all in Jock Dance Appearance, but I was a bit too wild for that kind of thing. I was a bit of a lad at the time, and we went to Sweden, the three of us, and we played a load of gigs in Sweden. I met Dieter Andersson, who's now in La Banda Europa then. That was, it must have been 1981 or something, that was a long time ago. And I remember that, and then we got Norman Chalmers involved and we created the Easy Club. That was the first Easy Club, and then we broke up, reformed with John Martin, fiddle player, and that was the incarnation of the Easy Club that sort of went on to make two or three albums and was a real vehicle for my writing of tunes.
Well, let me ask you about that, because that first album, the Easy Club, 1984. I mean, that was one of the most amazing things to me and one of my biggest influences. I remember listening to it on my radio underneath a pillow and being totally surprised and enlightened by it. But your playing style at that time was, I think people don't remember nowadays how amazing you were playing a cittern at that point, and your Boran skill, there's probably not been a better Boran player than you, but people don't really talk about that anymore. How did you get to that level of amazing musicianship?
Amazingness?
Yeah.
I think by being obsessive, really. You know, I'm pretty obsessive, and I think I'm pretty dogged, and I'm pretty ambitious, and I if I decide that I'm going to do something, I put everything into making it happen, you know. And so for me, learning to play the baran and having listened to pipe band music, listening to the likes of Alec Duffert, who was the drummer of the Shots, and listening to, you know, these amazing tabla players and Shakti, and at the same time playing along with Irish Wizards, all on albums. You never met any of these people at that time. And just made me, there was nothing, there were no boundaries really. I was just kind of playing with what I had. And I would just sort of settle down. I put on every day, these same three albums, every day, for weeks and months, while I put on weight and my asthma got worse, and I was smoking 45s a day, and ended up in hospital with bronchospasm. And nevertheless, I ended up also being able to play my instruments. And I was playing the bouzouki, and eventually I got a sitar. In fact, I got a sitar because Margie thought it would be good for Mark to have a sitar. That allowed me to have access to melodic and chordal stuff. But in terms of how I got to be the player that I was then, I suppose I just wanted to be.
Yeah. I mean, that, I've talked to you about this before, the solo, the Boran solo on Billy Jackson's Well Part Suite has to be one of the finest Boran solos ever.
Uh-huh.
The, you duet with a drum kit.
Yeah, with Alex. Oh, that was great. That was amazing. You know, I don't know what date that was.
89, 88.
Was it as late as that? No, that was a great opportunity for me, you know, and I remember May, who was my wife at the time, saying to me, Jim, whenever you're doing a gig, you need to do a baran solo. You need to do a baran solo because you're good at that. And so I didn't sort of take a lot of persuading people somehow or other to let me do it. And I'd learned to play tunes on it as well, play bass lines and play melodic lines. And occasionally, there were really simple tunes like When the Saints Go Marching. She did cheesy stuff like When the Saints Go Marching In. But I would be playing all this kind of stuff, and I'd invented this brush stick thing, and which was basically two drum brushes stuck together with a stick behind them. But it allowed me to play swishy, brushy stuff and thumpy, thuddy stuff. A lot of people use brushes now. At the time, there weren't really anybody doing that, and. But it also allowed me to play rhythm that was light with the brushy part, and the stick could go into the drum, and I could play notes and get nice big thuddy notes. So I would play tunes and accompany them rhythmically with the brushy bit and use the stick end hitting the drum to play the notes. And so you would end up, I would end up with people whistling along. So I'd start playing a tune. There's two or three simple wee tunes that I played that everybody kind of knew, and people would just whistle along. So it's quite funny to be playing a drum and have the audience singing along with it in some way or whistling.
And but of course at that time as well, running alongside is all your, well, some of your most famous compositions in terms of writing 16 bar tunes, Easy Club, Rio Dreams, North Sea Chinaman. The list goes on. Your book, The Flow Country, of course. Did that come out around that time as well?
Yeah, it did. The book was later. The book was, but it was around that time. Well, yeah, it probably was around that time. And funny, you know, I kind of was so, it's this obsessive thing that I have. I was so obsessed with doing it, so into writing music, into, and the music that I wrote, the tunes that I wrote, for folk tunes that I wrote, they grew out of me loving pipe music. There are lots written that can be played on the pipes. And there were some that were written specifically for pipers. And there were tunes that were written more for the fiddle. But mainly I was writing stuff to play myself. And I sort of got to the stage with playing tunes that I overstretched my abilities to play them. And I also, I think I was messing around with substances, and which made me a little bit sort of paranoid and a bit kind of not able to perform in the end. And so the combination of that slight sort of stage fright sort of block in my playing, and the fact that I was writing tunes that were harder and harder for myself to play, meant I ultimately ended up stopped playing melodic instruments, kept playing the drums for a while. And so that must have been just towards the end of the 80s. Coincidentally, my son was born in 1988, and I thought, I'm going to come off the road. So I stopped travelling, I stopped doing that, and started doing community art stuff and all that kind of stuff, and still continued to do sessions with the drum, with Baran particularly, and with other percussion. So I ended up playing lots of interesting people. So I had an outlet for my performing ego, as it were, in that. But actually most of my time from then, I spent producing stuff. You know, I met Carlos Arredondo and Galo Saron, a couple of Chilean singer-songwriters. Galo is a guitar player. And produced Hamish Henderson introduced me to them at a political event in Glasgow, a big political Cayleys. Jim, come over here. And I met Carlos, and I want to make a tape. I mean, they've been exiled from Chile in, I think, 77, so they've been in Scotland for 10 years or something like that. You know, he said, oh, Jim, I want to make a tape. They made tapes in those days. And I said, okay, yeah, I'll help, you know, and I just did. We went to Beer House Studios on the 8-track, Studer 8-track machine that was in the Beatles recorded on Abbey Road, which Peter, who owned the studio, had bought, and we did this album there of Carlos and Galo. And I did one or two other albums there for 784 Theatre and different people, Café and Tony Cuff was involved in that. Lots of people, lovely. And found that I was really enjoying this role of being the producer as well. So I found I found this other thing that I began to obsess about, and that was producing, you know, and getting involved in. I think it was came from the community stuff that I'd been doing, and realizing that I quite like working with people, and I like this sense of actually helping people to focus what they were doing, and helping I like to be creative, you know, I like to be creating. And so production for me, producing other people's music, allowed me to do both those things. It allowed me to do music, be creative, and work with people. And so that was a lovely thing to find, that I could do that, you know, at a time when people still wanted to.
And you did it pretty well, because there were some real classics in there. You mentioned Cathy Ann McPhee, there was Sabourna Stevenson.
Yeah, Gordon Duncan.
The two amazing Gordon Duncan albums.
Yeah, there were lots of good things.
Shural Nifty, I'll just mention them.
Yeah, we did three albums.
Three classic. Celtic Celtica,
yeah,
classic.
Couple of theirs. Yeah, quite good. Yeah.
So amazing. I would say albums that defined the 90s.
Yeah, that's true. I think the 90s was, and it was a time when there were sort of budgets to make albums, and people could actually get the money back, so it didn't feel like you were, you know, these days I think it's very hard for people to employ producers, because ultimately you're doubling your costs by having a producer, you know, and people don't make that much money out of albums. But in those days, people could actually make the money they spent back and make a little bit of money, as well as having a really good marketing tool for their gigs and creating some kind of legacy. So I think the 90s was a very interesting period for music. There was a lot more freedom than there is now, I think. And that's right across the board.
So after all that, all the production and everything in, so does that take us to the 2000s?
Well, I mean, there was, I suppose so. I mean, there was a lot of kind of crazy stuff going on for me in the 90s, because we had that band with you, for instance.
Oh, some other band, yeah. Yes.
And again, that was a bunch of jazzers and a bunch of folkies. and it wasn't that well organized really or anything. We just kind of got together, didn't we? You know, and it could have been any one of our bands really. I don't, you know, I think I kind of ended up writing some tunes and we did them, but ultimately we all sort of did what we did in it, and it wasn't rocket science in terms of its organisation, you know, but it was a great thing to do. And that gig we all did in Glenuig was wonderful at the Glenuig Festival. And I suppose there was, I was doing a lot of stuff like working with other people like, you know, June Tabor and Maddie Pryor, Jimmy Page and Robert Plant, and all these kind of things at the time as well. So I was in tandem with doing production and doing some writing. I was doing a lot of telly stuff I didn't like. I got into doing documentary things, and which is fine, but ultimately wasn't great for me to do that. And that came out of doing a film called Play Me Something with John Berger, who sadly died last year, and Timothy Neat. And it was Hamish Henderson who got me that job. So Hamish, he's been there quite a lot in my development. You know, he's gone, oh, Jim would be a good guy for that. You know, you can get Jim in for that. And so doing that film and made me end up doing quite a lot of film and television type stuff. Not always as interesting as that film was, you know. And ultimately, after about 95, I'd kind of decided that I was fed up with doing documentaries and things, and I wanted to do something else. And suddenly I got the phone call from Honey Bianchi asking me if I'd go and play with Jimmy Page and Robert Plant. I didn't know who they were. And Jimmy Page and Robert Plant, Robert Palmer, Robert Sweet. And then somebody, Ian McLeod from Jiggle Lifty, said, those are the guys from Led Zeppelin, Jim, you probably want to do that. And so I went off and did that and played with them for a while and did an album with them, and we did Jules Holland and all that stuff, and the MTV Unplugged. And that was a very interesting time for me. But again, it was short-lived, you know. It was a sort of, oh, and then it kind of went back to normal again, you know. So I'd reached that point where, you know, that was the end of that, and I think, what'll I do now? I'd always been really interested in songs, dating back from working with Mark and Margie and her song thing. I thought, I'm going to write songs. And so I wrote an album's worth of songs. I met Sylvia Ray singing in a pub of the jazz dynasty family that is the Ray family. And she introduced me to her sister, Gina, and also Sophie Bancroft, and of course the three of those were also in some other land with you, Simon. But eventually we kind of split off from that, and Sylvia and Gina became a singing duo called The Lanterns, along with me playing guitar actually. And I wrote a bunch of songs for that, and got signed to Sony. And so the first songs that I'd written, somehow or other, ended up on an album on Columbia Records, and I was published by Sony as a songwriter. That lasted till, for, you know, we had a number two in the UK dance charts with a Todd Terry remix. We charted with another single as well, and then everything kind of petered out because that was the end of the music industry. So that was a kind of another big moment that sort of just kind of slightly went, you know. And so around about 2000 we got dropped by Sony, and we got dropped by Columbia Records, and I thought, what are we going to do now? And I thought, I'm going to have to try and consolidate what it is that I've been doing in all of this period of time, because by that time I was about 40, and I thought, I was exactly 40. I was having a midlife crisis and thinking, what am I going to do? So I thought, I'll consolidate my kind of folk stuff, my producing, my writing, and the kind of film side of stuff, you know, that I was doing, and I'll find a way to kind of move forward. So I spent 5 years pretty skint, I have to say, and, you know, in massive debt, and going, what am I going to do? And at the same time I was doing stuff and started to think about what things I might do, and got the job doing the music for Festival, the film that I talked about earlier on in 2004, which gave me the idea for La Banda Europa, which seemed to be a great way of getting me doing the sort of folk side of stuff that I was doing again, and pulling that in, and finding myself actually managing to do what I'd set out to do, and consolidating these different strands of what I'd been doing, production and all of that, and moving forward and doing that.
So, and I suppose there was a few projects all the way through that, but I suppose it takes us right back to La Banda Europa,
yeah,
where we are now. So, what's the future? Where else can you go?
Well, it's with La Banda Europa, it's a big thing for me, and you know, I'm of an age now where I don't really want to just keep having new ideas. I do. Unfortunately, keep having new ideas, but and so that's a rod for my back, because you have an idea, and ultimately that idea takes maybe 4 or 5 years of coming to fruition. With La Banda Europa, yeah, 2004 had the idea. 2006 we got the first lot of funding. We did a few gigs. We did our last gig in Marseille, which you came along to in 2010, and I shelved it. And then more recently, we've had quite a societal seismic shift, really, it seems like, which is, you know, symptoms of that include Brexit, Donald Trump, and you know, the stuff that's going on in Belarus at the moment, and all over the world, actually. We're seeing the rise of totalitarian and authoritarianism, and I just made me think I've got to do something about this, and La Banda Europa is a great vehicle for showing that people can be different together, and celebrating humanity, and celebrating a sense of us people. We are, you know, an ocean, and the idea that we're an ocean. And so that's become a kind of mantra for me in recent months. So the plan is really to keep that going, and to develop La Banda Europa on into the future, to create a youth band as well, and to actually really sort of create a legacy for myself, actually, but also for the work that we've all been doing, and to bring people together, and to do something that's about something. And I think that's, for me, that's what it's all about now, is doing music that has a reason, and not just doing music, you know. And that may be a bit of a rod for my back, because, you know, it's not easy, but...
Well, that's great, Jim. Thanks very much.